Okay, hello everybody. So first of all, I want to thank you for giving me the opportunity to present my work, which I did at together with Professor Lars Schäfer from Ruhr University in Bochum, Germany, and with Professor Franz Mölder from University of Aarhus in Denmark, about how we used NMR relaxation data to improve the dynamics of massive groups in amber and charm force fields. So this is a collaborative project between NMR relaxation experiments and MMD simulations. And our original idea was not to to improve the force fields. So our original idea was to describe the stability of proteins in solutions. And the reason that we reprioritized the force field was just that we, on the way, we found out that the force fields for massive group rotations are actually incorrect. So that's why I also want to start to describe a little bit the thermostability of deeper lysozyme and connect this thermostability with the role of the conformational entropy for the stability of this protein. And then I like to do the connection between the conformational entropy and NMR order parameters and relaxation rates. And from these relaxation rates, I will then show that the current force fields, at least current amber and charm force fields, don't describe the dynamics of the rotation of massive groups in protein side chains correctly. And then I want to show you how we reprioritize these force fields with quantum chemical calculations. After this, I like to comment about the applicability of the famously Parisabo model, which is used to extract NMR order parameters from MD simulations for the description of the dynamics of massive groups. And I want to finish my talk with an evaluation about current amber and charm force fields for the description of the dynamics of proteins based on NMR relaxation data for protein backbone and sidechain. So let's start with the thermostability of T4 lysozyme. So one of the main changes in biochemistry is the discovery of new drugs. And one of the approaches to find new drugs is that you mutate already existing drugs in order to improve its functionality or its behavior depending on some external stimulus. Here we focused on a very stable protein solution, T4 lysozyme, which is also used for many force field studies. And we especially were looking at different leucine to alanine mutations of these proteins. Also, all these leucines residues which we mutated to alanines are directed to the inner part of the specific domain in the protein. So when you mutate such a bigger sidechain to a smaller sidechain like alanine, then you increase some cavity volume in the vicinity of the sidechain. And you would assume that the increase in cavity volume which you get by if you always perform the same kind of mutation in a stable protein would be similar. However, this is not the case. So the increase in cavity volume range from about 30 angstrom cubic to more than 100 angstrom cubic, depending on where you do the kind of mutation. An immediate explanation for this would be that you have somehow a structural change. If you compare the crystal structures of these mutants and compare them with the crystal structure of the wild type, then you see that the C-alpha RMSD is lower than 2 angstrom. So there is no real structural change which could be explained the different increase in cavity volume upon mutation. So our assumption was that the reason for this different increase in cavity volume is probably an entropic effect and not an enthalpic effect. So what we then did is there are some free energy calculations with Pimax, whose main developer, Vitalis Gapsis, was giving, I think, some of the last talks in the webinars of the Open Force Field Initiative. And we also did some entropy calculations upon mutation. And we found that there was just a modest correlation between the increase in cavity volume and the free energy difference between mutant and wild type. But there was a clear linear relationship between the change in entropy and the change in the cavity volume. This talk is not intended to be a free energy talk, but this result motivated us to look closer to the reason why we have this correlation between the entropy and the cavity volume. And therefore, we wanted to know to calculate the conformation entropy on a pair residue basis. In general, if you calculate the entropy difference between two systems, so in this case, a mutant and a wild type, you can have different kinds of contributions. You can have a change of entropy coming from the conformation entropy of the protein, from the rotation and translational motion of the full protein, from the solvent, or from other influences which are not further specified here. In case of T4 lysozyme, which is very stable and which does not change its structure and shape upon mutation, one can easily see that the change in configuration entropy dominates the full entropy change. The change of the configuration entropy can be then described as the change of the entropy of the protein backbone and the change of the entropy of protein side chains. In general, one also has a coupling term, but usually this coupling term is small in comparison to the individual contributions of from backbone and side chain. Changes in configuration and entropy in general are connected to changes in the dynamics of the phase space. And this dynamics can be expressed by the orientation and motions of a representative bond of this phase space. So in case of the protein backbone, one could look at amide bonds because they are representative of the dynamics of the protein backbone, the specific residue. And in case of side chains, one would look at a bond which is at the end of the protein side chain, because bonds at the end of protein side chains, or the dynamics of bonds at the end of protein side chains, are dominated by the dynamics of all bonds of the side chain. Here we chose massive groups because of three reasons. First, we can easily measure them with NMR relaxation experiments by using NMR deuterium spin relaxation measurements. Second, 6 of 20 amino acids contain messel groups, so the configuration entropy which you would get from all side chains which contain messel groups is representative for the configuration entropy of the full side chain of the protein. And the third reason is that messel groups are always at the end of protein side chains, so their dynamics is representative for the dynamics of the full side chain. If you want to describe the dynamics of these bonds, then you can do NMR measurements, and you can describe the dynamics with NMR order parameters, which have values between 0 and 1, where 0 means that all orientations of the bonds are equally distributed, so you have a lot of flexibility. And 1 means that the orientation of the bond is always in the same direction, so a limited flexibility, which can then be directly connected to the configurational entropy. Amide order parameters have reported frequently in the literature for from MMD simulations and from NMR experiments, and they correlate quite well because describing the internal motions of amide bonds of the protein backbone is relatively easy. There are also several studies for describing order parameters for messy groups and protein side chains, but there are just few MD studies which calculate order parameters for messy groups and protein side chains, and these studies either look just at very simple test cases, or their correlation with NMR order parameters are relatively poor. And I'd like to describe you what is the reason for this. So in general, the order parameter is defined as the long-term limit of the internal time correlation function. That means we only focus on the internal motion, which you can easily extract from an MD simulation by overlapping every snapshot of the trajectory to a reference structure. In case of messel groups and protein side chains, there are several motions which contribute to this internal motion, or this internal time correlation function. The first kind of motions are very fast librational motions on the femtosecond time range. Then we have the rotation of these carbon-hydrogen bonds around the symmetry axis of the messel groups, which usually happens for a freely rotating messel group on a timescale of about 5 picoseconds. Additionally, because the messel groups are at the end of the protein side chains, their dynamics is also influenced by the dynamics of the other bonds of the protein side chains, which by themselves have fast librational motions, but can also have rotamer jumps on a picosecond to a nanosecond timescale. And if you want to completely describe the dynamics of these bonds, you also have to include the overall motion of the protein, which happens on a typical timescale of 10 nanoseconds, so the global tumbling of a protein of the size of T4 lysozyme. Motions of tab 1, 2, and 3 contribute to the decrease of the internal time correlation function. The fast messel rotation decreases the internal time correlation function to a value of 1 over 9, and then the time correlation function further decreases to its constant plateau value, which would correspond then to 1 over 9 times the messel excess order parameter, which is the value usually reported in literature. This order parameter is easily extractable from MD simulations. However, this is not the order parameter which is measured in NMR experiments. And therefore, there are many this is one reason why there are differences between order messenger access order parameters from MD simulations and M order parameters. In NMR, you usually put your protein in solution, you label it. In our case, we label it with deuterium. Then you you put it in a spectrometer, you apply a strong magnetic field so that the spins orient with respect to the energy levels with respect to the strong magnetic field. Then you apply a second magnetic field with the radio frequency pulse. The spins are out of equilibrium, and after releasing these perturbations, they relax back. And what you measure are relaxation curves whose time constants are, or whose inverse of the time constants are then the relaxation rates. And usually you measure a set of relaxation rates, which can then be converted to a set of spectral density, points of spectral density, which describe different contributions of the different frequencies of the motions of this point of interest. However, there are two problems from the NMR side. First, the first problem is that you only can measure specific points of spectral densities. You cannot measure the full spectral density. You can get more points of spectral density if you measure more with different magnetic field strengths or use something like field shuttling, but you will never get the full spectral density. And the second point is the spectral density is the Fourier transform of the time correlation function. Even if you could get the full spectral density and could get the full time correlation function, you cannot extract the time correlation function of the internal motion, because the time correlation function will be always an overlap between the internal motion of the bond and the overall motion of the full protein. Therefore, in NMR, you usually use a motional model, which is the so-called Lipau-Szabo model. This Lipau-Szabo model assumes that you have that the overall motion of the protein and the internal motion of the bond of interest are statistically independent. And if this is the case, then you can write the time correlation as a product of the time correlation of function of the overall motion of the protein and the internal motion of your bond of interest. The overall motion can be described as with an exponential decay on the rotational tumbling time of the protein for an isotopic protein. And the internal motion also decreases exponentially on a characteristic timescale tau f to its final value of 1/9 of the times the excess order parameter. If you assume such a model, then you can easily Fourier transform it, and you can use this model then to fit your points of spectral density. And that's how the NMR experimentalists get their order parameters. I want to mention three aspects here. The first aspect is that the basic assumption that the overall motion and the internal motion are statistically independent. This is usually validated if these two kinds of motions happen on different timescales. And therefore, this model is perfectly suited for the description of dynamics of M-mite order parameters, because the M-mite order parameters in structured regions like alpha helices, for example, have only very fast internal motions, these vibration motions on a femtosecond to picosecond time range, which are much faster than the overall motion of the protein. This does not have to be the case for messy groups at the end of the protein side chains, because their dynamics is also influenced by rotamer jumps, which can happen on the same timescale or even slower than the overall motion of the full protein. So one aspect I want to show you, or I want to comment on, is if this model is also valid for messy group, for describing the dynamics of messy groups in protein side chain. The second aspect I want to mention is that in this model, we describe the overall motion with an exponential decay on the rotational tumbling time of the protein. This is strictly only valid if you have an isotopic protein. For an anisotopic protein like T4 lysozyme, for example, one has to use bond-specific rotational tumbling times, because one has to consider the principal axis frame of the protein. And the third aspect I'd like to mention is that what you see from this approach is that the order parameters extracted from NMR experiments are different from the order parameters from MD simulations, as described on the previous slide. And therefore, our motivation was to this, to create a model where you can extract these order parameters in a similar way like they're extracted from NMR. So, and here's how our model works. So we usually start MD simulations, and then we remove the overall tumbling by overlapping every snapshot of the trajectory to a reference structure. Then we calculate the internal time collation functions of the bond of interests. And these internal time collation functions decrease to different kinds of motions, vibrational motions, rotation of the massive group around the symmetry axis, and also Rotermedge arms. And all these kinds of motions can be described as Singer exponential decays. So what we did is we fitted these internal time collation functions with a multi-exponential decay to get a smooth time collation function in an analytical form. In order to get the full time collation function, we also have to add the overall motion. But here we need the rotational tumbling time of this specific massive group, which we cannot get because the orientation of the massive group changes in the principal access frame of the protein during the MD simulations. But we know that for a structured protein like T4 lysozyme, the amide bonds of the protein backbone keeps their position in the principal access frame of the protein. And we also know that for these amide bonds, the Lipase Harbour model definitely works. So that's why we introduce the tumbling time from the protein backbone. We use this Lipase Harbour model to fit the full-time correlation function with tumbling for the amide bonds. Then we use structure information to convert these rotational tumbling times to rotational tumbling times in the principal access frame of the protein. And then we use the orientation of the massive group with respect to the orientation of the amide bond of the same residue in the protein backbone to convert the rotational tumbling times to the massive groups. And that are then the rotational tumbling times which we used in the formula on the left side. Of course, there are some assumptions in with this approach, but we made sure that the time collation functions which we extracted with this model are very close to the time collation functions which we got directly from the MD simulations. Once we have these time collation functions, we can easily Fourier transform them to get the spectral density. And then we used only the points which were measured in MR to fit them with the Lipase-Harbour model in the same way like the NMR values are extracted to get order parameters and time scales. But because we now have these points of the spectral densities, we can also back convert them to calculate relaxation rates. And these relaxation rates are directly measured in NMR, so they don't underlay on the assumption that the overall motion and the internal motion are separated, which we don't know if this is valid for massive groups at the end of protein side chains. Therefore, we did not compare order parameters between MD and NMR, but we compared directly the relaxation rates. And here I want to show you the relaxation rates, which we got from MD simulations with the M199 SB star IDN force field, compared to the relaxation rates from measurements of the group of Vitaly Tugarinov. At the top, you see the relaxation rate R of dy, which reports on the slow dynamics of these massive bonds and protein side chains. And on the bottom, you see R of dz, which reports on the fast dynamics. And the results which we got with the original 99 SB star IDN force field are the red dots. What you can see is that for both relaxation rates, most of the relaxation rates in MD are higher than the NMR values. And this is especially remarkable for the relaxation rate R of dz at the bottom. It's especially remarkable for this relaxation rate. So this means that especially the fast dynamics of massive bonds and protein side chains is too slow in MD simulations. So if we go back to the dynamics which influence the rotation of the massive group, which influence the dynamics of these carbon hydrogen bonds and massive groups, then the fast dynamics are either fast librational motions or the rotation of the massive group around the symmetry axis. The fast librational motions don't contribute to this strong overestimation of the relaxation rates. But the rotation of the carbon hydrogen bonds around the symmetry axis of the massive group do. So this rotation of the massive group around the symmetry axis is too slow in current MD force fields. And we looked in the force field. This rotation is described by diode angles, which end up in these carbon hydrogen bonds. And these diode angles have been introduced in the EMBA force fields in EMBA 194. Based on DFT calculations in 1986, where Essen was used as a test case. And to our surprise, these dietary angles haven't been changed for most of the AMBA force fields, except for the 15 IPQ force fields, which reperturbed all the dietary angles. So probably the same dietary angle terms are should be still in the newest AMBA force fields. There is one paper from Chatfield in 2002 who found that also these energy barriers of massive rotation are too high for alanine sidechains in the CHARM22 CMAP force field. And he suggested new force parameters for alanine, which he then transferred also to the mass group of the other sidechains. We thought that this transferability from the mass groups of alanine to mass groups of other sidechains probably is not the best idea. And one may has to reparameterize these dietary angles site-specifically or sidechain-specifically. And that's actually what we did. So we created block dipeptides for every side chain of proteins which contain messing groups. And for these block dipeptides, we created the backbone configuration, so the five side data angles, in either in an extended configuration or in a helical configuration. And we did not really see an influence of these backbone configuration on the height of the energy barriers of messing rotation. For the sidechains, we use the most populated rotameric state based on the rotameric library, but we also tested it with other rotameric states, and the influence is on the energy barriers of massive rotation is not negligible. So it's about, but it's relatively small. It's about 0.5 to 1 kilojoule per mole, depending on which rotameric state you are. And for these rotameric states, then we rotated the massive group in around the symmetry axis in 5-degree steps in an interval over 120 degrees to get the full profile. And for all these structures, we did a DF potential energy scan with the M062X functional and the double theta basis set to get the profile of massive rotation. In case of alanine, for all structures, and for, in case of the longer side chains for the structures close to the maximum and minimum, we then performed coupled cluster CCSDT calculation with a triple theta basis set in order to get an accurate estimation of the energy barriers. And the energy barriers from the coupled cluster calculations are actually lower than from the DFT calculations. We then did the same with the force field, so the 99SB star IDN force field, and found that these energy barriers are higher for all sidechains except for threonine in the original force field. Subsequently, we then reduced the prefactor of these dietary angles, which contribute to this massive rotation accordingly, specifically for every massive group in every sidechain. And then we did this parameterization again, or actually we did these calculations again with this reparameterized force field and could get a nice correspondence to the CCSDT calculations. With these new parameters, then we did all the MD simulations of ubiquitin and water again, calculated again the relaxation rates, and the results are now the blue triangles which you see. What you see is that these blue triangles have now lower values in comparison to the original the values from the original force field, and they are at least now in the correct frequency range. One may think that, or one sees that the correlation for these fast dynamics, so the RFT Z relaxation rate, is still very poor, and this is the reason that has the reason that we have a very complicated dynamics of these protein side chains, and these complicated dynamics on the picosecond time range result in this poor correlation. We then did the same parameterization for these 15 IPQ force field and also for the CHARM36 force field, and also found that the rotational barriers also in these force fields are too high in comparison to the force field in comparison to the CCSDT calculations. So we reparameterized also then these parameters and could reproduce much better relaxation rates for both force fields. We then looked at the spectral densities and the time correlation functions because they describe the full dynamics of these carbon hydrogen bonds and massive groups. And on the left side, you see the results for the original force field for a specific massive group. So in this case, the C gamma messyl group is isoleucine 61 of ubiquitin. And on the right side, so you see the spectral density of which we extracted from the new force field, especially the high frequencies, which we reparameterized, are now much better captured in the new first field than in the old force field. The reason that that we get a discrepancy at the zero frequency is that our MD simulations are performed in normal water, and the NMR experiments are done in heavy water. And heavy water, of course, tumbles a little bit slower than normal water. And if you include this effect, then we also can reproduce J of zero correctly. And importantly for the water parameters is the reproduction of the internal time correlation function. And here you see the same messyl group as an example, and the original force field decreases too slow in comparison to the new force field in green, which gives internal time correlation functions very close to the NMR values, which are represented here by the blue line. With these new force fields, we can now investigate if the Lipau-Szabo model is valid for the description of the dynamics of messyl groups in protein sidechain. And what we did is we compared now the internal time correlation function, which we got directly from the EMD simulation, with the internal time correlation function, which we got after we calculated the spectral density, fitted it with the Lipau-Szabo model, and used the fitting parameters of this Lipau-Szabo model to calculate the internal time correlation function. We calculated the root mean square relative error between these two internal time correlation functions over the first 10 nanoseconds of this internal time correlation function. And what you see here are the results for all messy groups in for T4 lysozyme. What you can see is that for most of these messy groups, the root mean square relative error between these two internal time correlation functions is lower than 0.5%. But for some messy groups, the difference between these two internal time correlation functions is relatively high. And I'd like to give you an example for both cases. In both cases, I chose a messy group which is connected to the C delta atom of an isoleucine side chain. In the first case, I look at the I present you the results for the isoleucine 150 sidechain. And this sidechain does not have rotamic jumps during the MD simulation around the sidechain data angles chi1, chi2. This means for the internal time correlation function that this time correlation function decreases very fast to a value of 1/9 due to the fast messyl rotation around the symmetry axis, but then stays constant for the rest of the time. And the Lipau-Szabo model is able to fit this internal time correlation function correctly. In case of the sidechain isoleucine 27 and T4 lysozyme, we find several rotamer jumps between two rotamer states around the sidechain data angle chi2 on a time scale of 1 to 2 nanosecond. This means for the internal time correlation function that this function also decreases to a value of 1/9 on a time scale of about 5 picosecond, but then further decreases on lower timescales due to the slow dynamics. And the Lipau-Szabo model can only fit an intermediate time scale. That means that the Lipau-Szabo model is not valid for the description of all messy groups in protein sidechains, and one should take caution if one compares MD extracted relaxation rates with NMR, values. So, but how close we are now with the new force field in comparison to the NMR values. Here I show you the relaxation rates for extracted from MD simulation for T4 lysozyme compared to our measured relaxation rates. And what you see is that we get a quite good correlation. Of course, we have some noise still inside, which is more than when you look at the relaxation rates from the protein backbone, which I show you on the next slide. But we are much better than with the previous force fields. And quantitatively, we can reach now correlation coefficients about 0.7 to 0.8 between MD-derived relaxation rates and NMR-derived relaxation rates for protein of the size of T4 lysozyme. Finally, I'd like to show you some results of ubiquitin, which is easier protein like T4 lysozyme, and show you how far we are now with current force fields. So the results which I show you are now for all the force fields which I have shown previously, the 99SB star IDN force field, the FF15 IPQ force field, and the CHAMP36 force field. On the left side, so you see the relaxation rates for the protein backbone. So the transverse and the longitudinal relaxation rates at the top and the NOE relaxation rates at the bottom. All force fields are able to reproduce the structural features of ubiquitin, which is no surprise because ubiquitin is a very easy protein and also used in many force field development studies. But all force fields are not just able to reproduce the correct structure features, but also the correct quantitative value, which means that also the dynamics of the protein backbone bonds is correctly captured. Two points I'd like to point out here are the red peak in the transverse relaxation rate R2. This red peak comes from chemical exchange on a time scale of about 10 to 100 microseconds, which is not captured in our MD simulation, which had an aggregate simulation time of about 1 microsecond. And the second point I'd like to point out is the green line in the transverse relaxation rate R2 and in the NOE. This green line is the result of the CHAMP36 simulations with the TIP3P water model. The TIP3P water model has a self-diffusion which is 2.7 times faster than the normal self-diffusion, and therefore these relaxation rates are much lower than the relaxation rates from the other force field and also from the NMR values. We did not want to redo the CHAMP36 force simulation with another water model because we don't know if these protein solvent interactions change when we go to another water model. But what we did is we just scaled the diffusion time by this factor of 2.7, and then we could also get the correct relaxation times R2 and the NOE values. Quantitatively, we are now able to get correlation coefficients of about 0.9 for back relaxation rates. And for the NOEs, we are now able to get correlation coefficients of 0.99, which means that the dynamics of the protein backbone is now correctly described in current force fields. The situation is a little bit different for the protein side chains. So here are the results for these relaxation rates of meso groups. The correlation for the slow dynamics, so the relaxation rate of dy, is still quite okay, not as good as for the protein backbone, but we are able to, we are on the way to reproduce the nanosecond timescale correctly for protein side chains. However, for the fast dynamics, the correlation is still bad, even with the new reparameterized force fields. And this is due to the complicated dynamics which you have in protein side chains. Quantitatively, we can get now all correlation coefficients between 0.8 and 0.9 for the slow relaxation rate of dy and for the order parameter, but the correlation for the fast dynamics of dz is much worse. One can now ask the question why this correlation is much worse in comparison to the correlation on the previous slide for T4 lysozyme, if T4 lysozyme is a much more complicated protein than ubiquitin. But the case for this is that T4 lysozyme contains 16 alanine residues and ubiquitin only contains 2. And alanine residues have a much faster dynamics than the other side chains and can also so separate it easily from each other. And therefore, the correlation coefficient is much higher if you have a lot of alanines in your protein. Based on these results, which I've shown you, I'd like to give some consequences for future force field developments. First of all, my reparameterizations were done for these messy group rotations and protein side chains. And chemically, that are always sp3 hybridized carbons, which are connected to sp2 hybridized carbons, except for methionine, where these carbons are bonded to a sulfone atom. One might expect that this similar chemistry should give similar force field parameters for the energy barrier of meso rotation, but this is not the case. What we see is that we get similar energy barriers based on the distance to the protein backbone. For example, we get clearly different energy barriers for the C gamma and the C delta energy barriers in isoleucine, but we get similar values between the C gamma messy groups in isoleucine and leucine, and we get also similar values for the barriers of messy rotation between the C delta messy group in isoleucine and the C delta messy groups in leucine. Another aspect which we one maybe have to consider in the future is that we got slightly different values for the energy barriers of mass rotation for the different rotameric states. And one may have to include this for future force field developments. In general, our results show that the dynamics of protein backbone bonds are well captured in modern protein force fields, but the dynamics of side chains still has to be improved, especially for the fast dynamics on the picosecond time range. And with this, I would like to summarize my talk. So I reparameterized the dynamics of messy group. I reparameterized the rotation of carbon-hydrogen bonds around the symmetry axis of messy groups. And these new force field development, force field parameters better capture NMR due to relaxation rates, spectral densities, and time correlation functions. Furthermore, we created a new spectral density mapping approach to calculate order parameter, and I did not show this in this presentation. But this new approach reproduces better messy order parameter than just taking the long-term limit of the internal time correlation function, which is described in a PCCP paper from 2018. And furthermore, we investigated if the Lipari-Szabo model describes the dynamics of carbon-hydrogen bonds correctly. And this is the case for most of the messy groups, but for some messy groups, the Lipari-Szabo model is not valid to describe the dynamics correctly, and one may have to think to create a better model to describe these dynamics to fit the NMR data. And finally, the MD force fields are able to capture the amplitude of motions better than their precise timescales. I'd like to thank my PI, Professor Lars Schäfer from University in Bochum, Germany, and also Professor Franz Möller from University of Aarhus in Denmark for their support, and also Dr. Menjun Tsui from University of Aarhus, who is now in Seattle in Washington State, and who did the NMR experiments on T4-lysozyme. And I also want to thank my full Schäfer group and my funding organization Resolve for funding. And I also want to thank you for your attention. And before I finish, I'd like to mention that the code for these new force field parameters is available on our webpage, molecularsimulation.org/downloads. And it will be soon also available on my GitHub account, which in the moment is still empty. And I also will upload the code, how we calculated the order parameter of and the relaxation rates of messy side chains soon to this GitHub account. Again, I want to thank you for paying attention, and now I am open for questions.